3分、3分ぐらいのはずなのに、もう始まる人も出てくるかも。マイクも切って。3分、マイクも切って。3分、マイク、喋ってる人のところが画像になっちゃうんですよ。
大丈夫。自分たちが見えないだけですよ。大丈夫。でもそれ見えないと困るのか。カメラの。そうです。はい。そうですね。何が映ってるか。よっしゃ。じゃあ始めましょうか。来なくてもいいですか。
On the Hanji. Okay. So let's start today's seminar. And today's speaker is Professor Masaki Kashiwara from Riemann-Kyoto University. And the title is Riemann-Hilbert Correspondence for Irregular Holonomic D Modules.
So, thank you very much. And I'm very happy to. Today I'm going to speak about Riemann-Hilbert correspondence for irregular holonomic D modules. So for regular holonomic D module, the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence is well understood, and more or less the category or the derived category of D modules correspond to the derived category of constructible or constructible genes. And we want to generalize it to the irregular case. And so let me start by the classical theory of ordinary differential equations. And so we consider the ordinary differential equation. I think that is very classical, but I think some of them know it very well, and some of them don't know at all. And so we assume that they are holomorphic with one variables, and we assume that AM vanishes at some point. Then zero, say here somewhere, and we say that Z0 is a regular singularity of this ordinary differential equation if order of 0 at Z equals 0, AK is greater than Z equals order of 0 of AM minus N minus K. Okay, for any K. In this case, we say that is a regular singularity. And in this case, the behavior of local solution is very well understood. And more or less, you said there are locally around the zero, there are solutions of the form more plus some logarithmic term that I skipped that part, and more or less you say is determined as a power lambda plus that is a convergence power series, and there are m solutions of this form. So of course that has order m, and outside the singularity it has m independent solutions, and other singularity that is very well described. And so any solution have, so this lambda gives the monodromy around the singularity, and that is a regular case. And so if you consider holonomic solutions, say we shall denote this operator P, P equals zero, it is a local system outside singularities, and so that is the monodromy, and more or less we might put correspondence in a classical sense is the correspondence of a local system and differential equation with ordinary system variables. And more generally, that can be generalized to a more general term by the D modules. So if it is a complex manifold, I'll not explain the detail, but there are the ring of differential operators, and there are notions of dx modules and holonomic. So that is more or less a generalization of ordinary differential equations, linear differential equations, and regular holonomic. There are notion of regular holonomic D module. That is a more or less a generalization of ordinary differential equations with regular singularity. And in this framework, so we have the following correspondence, more or less. So we consider mode, perhaps let's write dx. So that is a derived category of D modules. And there is a functor to, so that is the derived category of sheaves of vector spaces on X. And that is given, say, solution. It is effective contrafined functor. And the solution is just take the so-called solution and OX. OX is the simplest D model. And it contains holonomic. So that is a derived category of D modules with holonomic cohomologies, and that is the regular holonomic cohomology. And it contains, of course, the irregular holonomic, and this caused, in fact, the Tx, that is the full subcategory of DBCX with constructible sheaves as commons. And here there is, and here there are some categories so-called purpose sheaves. And the classical or the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence in regular case says that is an isomorphism or equivalence of categories, and that is an equivalence of categories. So this part is more or less algebraic part or analytic part, and that is a topological. And in the regular holonomic case, we can describe algebraic part in terms of topological terms. And the problem is how we treat the regular case, general case. So that is a regular case, and in the regular case, the algebraic part can be described by the more or less constructive sheaves, or the constructive sheaves. And so, in general, this does not hold, and the situation is well understood, but a little bit complicated. So, irregular case. So, we don't assume this condition. Then what happened is, so we change the variable a little bit to consider some R. You change a variable, you got the project covering a little bit. Then there are M linear independent common solution of the form Z times W power lambda C0 plus C1W plus C1. So this part is very similar to that. And phi is a Riemann polynomial. And the problem is it is not convergent in general. But there are m linear independent formal solutions of the form. And more precisely, you have to add log to W, but I'll not explain. So that is a formal part. And analytically, we can say, so there are formal solutions. And analytically, you have the following. You have Z0. You consider any direction, and then you take very small sector, sufficiently small sector, so that is in any direction, and you take a sufficiently small sector, then there is a holomorphic solution defined on S such that U is asymptotically. So it means this condition utilized asymptotically to the formal solution means you cut off this formal process. Say n, n, then the difference is the more or less remaining. So in that sense, that is asymptotically equivalent to U. And you can find such holonomic solutions. And because there are M linearly independent formal solutions, and to each formal solution you can find a holonomic solution, so you can find M linearly independent solution on the sector. But the problem is, U tilde is not unique. There are many choices, in fact. So I will explain a little bit. So if you have another solution, say, so on, and then you can find your prime tilde that is asymptotically equivalent to this formal solution. And assume that the real part of P prime W is smaller than the real part of P of W on its sector. Then exponential part is very much smaller than exponential P. So it means, for example, if you take U tilde plus some constant prime, that is because this part is very small comparing to exponential t, that is again asymptotically equivalent to U. So it means, so in the regular case, that is unique, so you can find exactly the solution. But in irregular case, this holonomic solution is not unique, and modulo something lower than that. So it means more. So in fact, there are several people like Malebranche or Turin, who tried to analyze the ordinary differential equations, their idea is to extract this part. So it means, so by in this way, you have an ordering over the Laurent polynomial, and by this, so the module lower order term, you meet U tilde is determined. So the naive idea is you consider the filtration and each filter is filtered by theta. And so by this filtration you consider the solution smaller than phi, exponential phi, then that gives a filtration, and if you take phi solution, then your tilde is uniquely determined. In this way, in some sense, we can treat the irregular case. But the problem is, it's very hard to derive it to the several complex variables case by this idea. But here, already something appeared. Of course, that is we at the beginning we didn't think about that, but after finding the solution with Andrea D'Agnolo, we can interpret this in other way. So to consider situation is in fact to add one variable. So for example, in usual case, that is filtered by Fn, and to consider the filtration by Fn is, you can say, you consider n, it's not, but something like that, or at least smaller. Then that is a local constant, some part, and that is, that is to give this one is more or less equivalent to this. So that is a shift in one value. So to or in another term, you consider this one. But anyway, so to consider filtration is more or less described by adding one value. So the idea, so to treat the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence in irregular holonomic meromorphic case, there are two ideas. One idea is add one value. So that replaces the filtration. And another idea is, here we need some gross condition. So for example, this condition is equivalent to some asymptotic behavior. So it means we have to think about the gross condition. And so gross condition is very difficult to treat in the shift theory. And we have to generalize that part. So we consider, in fact, some anarchic shift or ind-sheaves. Okay, so I wrote an article and Daniel, and that is in the archive. And in the archive, I use the terminology or the notion of ind-sheaves. And that is more or less equivalent to subanalytic sheaf that is explained in the paper also. I think perhaps that is a little bit more understandable for the audience. So I think I'll speak in the language of subanalytic sheaf in this talk. And that's, okay, so let me explain first subanalytic subset. So you subanalytic. I think that notion is due to Hironaka and others. And so let us take a real analytic manifold. And subanalytic subset. Subsets of M. So that is the smallest family of subset of M that satisfies a certain condition. One, first one, is for any proper real analytic map, And S is a real analytic manifold. Its image is contains its image. So image is sub-analytic. I mean, this family contains the image. And second is stable by complements, by taking the complements. And locally finite image. So it means if you have a locally finite family of subanalytic subsets, then its union is again a subanalytic subset. So the subanalytic subset is the smallest family that is obtained by taking the complement locally finite union starting from the image of the proper element. So that is a subanalytic set. And subanalytic set is a very good set. It means, so as you know that for subsets for example, if you take some significant manifold and you take an intersection, it can have, for example, many connected components. It can happen. But in this case, for example, subanalytic set, as locally finite. Component. And each connected component is a subanalytic. And there are a lot of. And more or less, for subanalytic set, there is no pathological phenomenon. That is a very good sense. Okay, so that's a subanalytic set. And so what is subanalytic sheaf? Subanalytic sheaf is the following. So you consider the subanalytic M. So that's an open subanalytic and relatively compact. Relatively compact means it is contained in a compact subset. Okay. And you consider it as a category by the inclusion. And so subanalytic. Or, of course, we get, that's fine. Is just the control blind factor to vector space, to the category of vector. And but of course, the usual sheaf is you consider a category of open subset. And control variance function. So that is a usual sheaf, and subanalytic pre-sheaf, and subanalytic pre-sheaf is so you restrict to only to open subanalytic and control subset. And for subanalytic sheaf, say F. So let us recall what is a sheaf. Sheaf is so if that is a covering, open covering, then that is irregular. So that is a definition of sheaf. But for subanalytic sheaf, the statement is similar. So that is exact if, of course, you must be subanalytic, UI must be subanalytic, but this one is a finite one. Then that one. So that is subanalytic. Why subanalytic sheaf is important and useful for our purpose? So because there are good examples of subanalytic sheaf. So that is why we consider subanalytic. So let us consider DBM. So that is a sheaf of distribution zone. Distributions. So we consider subanalytic sheaf of temporal distribution. Subanalytic compact support web, you take U, you associate image or DBM. So it means DBTU is a distribution only defined on U that can be extended to that whole space. And that is a subanalytic sheaf. Of course, that is subanalytic pre-sheaf, that is trivial, but that is also true. And that is, I think, we can say that is literally no assertions. Anyway, so that is what happens. So you have Mochizuki. So that is the category of sheaves, usual sheaves. And you consider one SA. So that is a subanalytic, the category of subanalytic sheaf. But I write MSA because, so of course that is a sheaf, so you can consider that is, in fact, a sheaf with respect to some quotidian category or site. Or, so it, in the sense that is a sheaf in the quotidian sense of subanalytic site. So in a sense, I write this. Whatever, anyway, and this one contains, so there's a functor, because you just restrict this functor to this one, then you can get this functor. So that is trivial, nothing. So this one contains all constructible sheaves. All constructible sheaves, so that is all constructible. So we say that F is R constructible, a sheaf is R constructible. So that is, you can imagine that F varies if there is a partition M is, say, MI. MI is the same locally closed subanalytic set. Subanalytic. And that is locally finite union. And if you restrict it to each strata, then that is a local constant of finite. Okay? And so, this functor, of course, and it contains a mode. So it is compact support. And the theory proportion is this subanalytic sheaves is in fact equivalent to the category of ind objects of so ind object is more or less so this so here it have of course the inductive roots. And it has inductive roots also, but this one does not commute. Does not commute. Or even inductive. So that is more or less, it says, any subanalytic sheaf can be obtained as a filter, as an inductive limit of filter on family of that are constructive sheaves with compact support. But anyway, so it can be described here by that. So that is comparable with, for example, you consider the category of vector space in the category of in the object of finite dimensional vector space. That is a kind of generalization. Yes. So anyway, so this one is next one. So you have this category is, in fact, and so if you have a map M to M, and then you consider the derived category of, so that is a derived category of of the category of subanalytic sheaves. Then you have operations, direct image, or then, for example, you have F inverse, F sheet, kappa sheet. Yes. And so that is very similar to the category of sheaves. You have six operations of quotientic, and it behaves very well. And a little bit, yeah, Okay, so we shall take this one. So, example. I speak about already that some analytic sheaf of temperature distribution. And say now X is a complex manifold. Then we have Xt. So that is, you consider some analytic sheaf of temperature distribution, and you consider durable complex. So you can consider it, and you consider this as in the derived cadre. And in fact, this complex is not concentrated in degree zero in general, so you have to go to the derived cadre. But you can define. So that is a very important ingredient for us. So, for example, we shall take the following example. You take X is a complex line, and M is dxz, so that is a differential equation, or D module generated by it, or explicitly dx over dx, z square. So that's the difference. And we consider solution. So that is one. Okay. So that is more or less. So that is complex, but so that is this query. In fact, so that is we can describe it very completely. So what happened is, it is at least H. So that is, so that is zero. So H is zero is limit of A goes to zero. So you have the origin and you have so that is a limit in the category of subanalytic sheaves. So that is not the limit in the category of sheaves. In the category of sheaves, that is very trivial. That is C and zero, of course. But in the category of subanalytic sheaf, that is not trivial. That is this one you can get easy. So that is very well. So it
what is this notation?
C sub
real one.
Yeah. So that is an open set. Z is not zero, and so it's smaller than A. So that is an open set. And that is a constant sheaf on this open set and extends zero. Mm-hmm. So that is that is a real part. But it's correct. Yes. Yes. Good. I think so. Yeah. And so that is a constant sheaf. And if it a goes to zero, then this little open set is shrinking, or it's a complement. So it's growing, and that is an inductive. So in fact, that is correspond to dBT U, zero. It's a subanalytic set, and that is tempered if and only if U is contained in this set. That is equivalent, and that is very easy. Okay, so that is this. So here, this is solution of T, and that is gives more concrete way. For example, if you consider this one, the usual solutions, then that homology is just a limit in the sense of sheaves, and so that is zero. And it describes more, it gives more or less. Yes?
Limit taken as sheaves?
No. Here, the limit is taken as a subanalytic sheaf. And if you take it as a sheaf, that is this one, a constant sheaf also zero, and that is a usual solution. So that is a sheaf. So that is very different. So in some sense, if you consider tempered one, then it describes a little better than the usual solutions, because you can recover more or less this one a little bit, but it's not perfect. For example, of course, by this one, so that is the solution B, two over Z, because if you change, say, exponential 2 over Z, then you have to change this part to 2 over Z. But of course, if you take the limit, they are the same. So you can distinguish also. So that is a little bit better than the usual solution. And so that taking the temperate distribution or temperate holonomic function or subanalytic sheaves, so it describes a little bit better, and so that gives some kind of so that describes more or less asymptotic expansions. But as I explained in the irregular ordinary differential equation case, we have to consider the situation, or we have to add one variable. So that is what I'm going to speak about. So we add one variable. So that is, in fact, a little bit motivated by the work of Tamarkin. First, I'll not explain about that. But so we consider more. So M is irregular.
Okay.
Yes?
So we have small problem. We
yes?
don't see well from Paris. So we don't see well from Paris.
It's a question of focus.
Well, yeah, yes, but I think
it's
slightly different. So we have small problems.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay. So we will just cut this. We will call you again in 2 minutes. So just wait 2 minutes, please.
Move out, it seems better.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah, it's better now.
Okay.
First.
Can we continue now?
Yes, please. Ah, okay, very good.
Okay, so...
Yes, please continue.
So, we had one variable, so we consider on a realized manifold, but we add one variable, and we take n times r. And I write the r infinity, it means the following. You have r. R can be compactified, for example, t is just one-dimensional real projective line. So the adding one point, R can be compactified. And so that is a subanalytic sheaf on N times R infinity. R infinity means you consider subanalytic set, the open subset M cross R. So we consider subanalytic M cross R infinity. So that is, you consider U, that is open subanalytic compact on M plus P, such that U is contained in M. And so you consider subanalytic sheaf. Subanalytic sheaf means you just consider it. Compactified. And so we consider this one, and then we consider the derived category. And it has a good operation of tensor product. It is not the usual one, so it's a little bit. It's usually called convolution. So you have three map, Q1, Q2. They are projections to the first factor or the second factor. And mu is the addition, x, T1, T2. Goes to x. And we define the tensor product I at plus in this category, that is R in the drive, and another on plus. Anyway, so you have these ones. So first, by this. So that is a tensor category, commutative tensor category. By and the unique object is C T cross. So it means M cross zero. The constant sheaf it concentrated to the origin. So that is a unit object. So if you tensor plus to any object, it goes to the same. And one, for example, in this category, K1, K3, so that is a home. K1 is a plus. So it means it behaves very similar way to the category of usual. And tensor plus is a tensor plus, and iron plus is a home. And moreover, we can define other operations. If we have M and perhaps at R,
And in fact, so we have a question from Paris.
Yes?
No, I just did. Can I
speak? Detector.
No, I just did not follow. What was the mu? Can you recall mu?
Mu. Mu is an addition map. Addition map. I'm sorry, Paris, you can't see. Addition map. So T1, T2 goes to T1 plus T2. So that is a usual, it corresponds to the convolution. The convolution. So it corresponds, of course, Fx. No, I think you understand. That's a convolution of the function. OK, so but that is not the end. So we consider another category, a little bit modified. Divided A such that K is pi in the pi star. Where pi is the map at R pi. M cross to M. So it means, so that is a triangulated subcategory of this one, and you consider the quotient. So that is a triangulated category. And that is, so that is important. So it means more or less K is constant along the fiber of this. And in this case, we say that it constant this one. And this condition is, in fact, equivalent to so, in fact, well, first, better do, right? Big one, and you have zero subcategory. And the other one you change the sign. Oh. And so, perhaps the time is running now. It's the commands. First K, and you have this one, and this one. After plus this one. The dark term, it contains this one. So, so the quotient of this is, the quotient of this is, so it is in fact divided into two, but I think that the time is running. And so, so that I will, So you go to this category, then it behaves like the usual category of sheaves. So for example, if you have the map, then you can define F star, F inverse, or so on, from ECM, ECM, and so on. So, and yeah, there's a functor, home functor, and so it has a six operation of quotient, and it feels very well, and it in a similar way. Now, we work in this category, I'm sorry, because I have to be quick. So now, so you take X is complex monopoly. And you define DV. X E. E is, it means enhanced. Enhanced means you add one variable. So that is more or less dvx in t, because of temperature distribution and t in max. So that is home. Ah, no, no, no. No, it's okay. And for X, E is turbo complex. Yes. And we replace all the things to this one. Then you can get the answer. So because the time is running, I think I can give the details, I'm sorry. And I think I will give the just. So you define solution. So M is the X solution is the seminar. X and so theorem is you have if you go to next, so that is faithful. And there is another factor, the construction factor along solution from N from X E. That is so I think it, I have to, no time to explain it, but that is home function, and if you take the home function, then you can recover N. So that is the final result. So the conclusion is, so you add one variable, and you consider a new category, then this new category behaves very in a similar way to the category of derived, to the derived category of the category of sheaves. And in that category, you have the enhanced, you have enhanced holonomic function. And you take the solution, then you can get an embedding. And that is the topological part, that is the analytic part or algebraic part. And you can get this free phase function, so you can realize this algebraic part as a full subcategory of the topological. And unfortunately, there are several problems. I don't know how to describe the essential image of this free faceful functor. And another one is you have, so this has a T structure, so the image must have a T structure, and I don't know how to describe the T structure. So in the regular holonomic case, that T structure is a perverse, but I don't know the description. Okay, I'm sorry. So, because I'm sorry that the just part is, I have to run because the time is not enough. I'm sorry. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So first, are there any questions from Paris?
Yes.
You define the category EBCM as the quotient of the derived category of M cross R infinity by a triangulated subcategory. And then you say
yes,
that you have operations like ROM and tensor product on the quotient.
Yes.
But
yes,
now, on before taking the quotient, you have some operations. So what is the relation between the operations on the quotient and the operation before the quotient, because is it the...
So for example, take this tensor case. So if K1 belongs to this subcategory,
yes,
then this tensor product belongs to this category.
Ah, okay.
So it gives the, it goes through to the quotient, right?
Okay.
And similar for props.
Can you define what is OX upper E?
OX upper E is you first define the temper distribution,
okay,
and you consider the durable complex.
Okay.
So that is the durable complex.
Okay.
So the construction is very similar to the OX.
And can you explain why the Poincaré lemma does not hold for the in your case you said that OX, that is the D-bar complex, is not exact in the sense of subanalytic sheaves?
You mean, yeah, because, so that is the case of the subanalytic sheaf. So for the subanalytic sheaf, so you consider complex. And if you take the concave one, then, of course, so that turbo complex is exact means for finite subdivision, it becomes exact. But it is concave, so it's, if it is concave, it's impossible by a finite subdivision. Subarctic sheaf is, you remember that that is the only finite union. So in this side, in this quadratic side, exact means after the finite many subdivision, it becomes exact. But it's impossible. So in a usual sheaf case, you can take infinite many. Then you can take a small one. But you have to take finite many, so it's impossible. I'm sorry, I cannot explain more.
We defined some convolution, and I was wondering, in the regular case or tame case, is that convolution product the same as usual tensor product?
You mean the regular case? What does that mean, regular case? You mean that convolution?
Yes, so you can also consider usual tensor product. So in which case do you have an isomorphism between usual tensor?
No, that's very different. For example, Ct is greater than A, tensor plus. So for example, M is point. Then T is B is just Ct is A plus B. There are more objects. In DB, of course, this has many objects, and that is a tensor product. So for the it's more rich than it richer than the usual category.
Yes, but in the
invariant
case, when you have thin
one,
you convolution is the same as additive convolution is the same as tensor product, essentially.
I'm saying that that is a tensor category that behaves similar to the usual category of derived category. So that is, so I just want to say this operation, this factor gives a tensor category structure or monoidal category structure on the derived category. That is what I want to say. And of course, that is not a usual tensor product. Not. And perhaps you know that that is very similar to the, if you have two iterations, okay? Then the good way to consider the iteration is just f I f prime j and j. Then this gives another iteration, and that corresponds to the tensor product. And by this, the filtered object is a tensor. We can say it's a tensor category, and that corresponds to this one.
Another question? So the function you construct extends, just to add a little bit to the question of Luke, so the function you construct extends the usual Riemann-Hilbert correspondence?
Yes. Yeah. Perhaps better to explain about that. Because that's originally I wanted to speak about that, but because there is no time, so I didn't explain that. But thank you very much for asking. So you have CX, and you have layer of holonomic, and the constructive CX, and so that's the inclusion, and there's the inclusion. And that is given by chi x plus. And chi x e is so limit of so that is what happens. So that is faithful. So by this you can recover. And and she actually, oh no, that's okay. That's she, huh? I don't know. I'm sorry. Tensor. F goes to pi. Pi is a amount of x. I'm sorry.
Other questions from Paris? If not, no more from Paris.
There was some formula on the blackboard that I did not. Can you go to the formula about dbxe just on the blackboard when you define db x and n on the right blackboard?
You mean this one?
Yes. So what is this? So you take you define the tempered thing, but now I don't quite see. Then you don't put the tempered on the other. I don't quite see what you are.
That is hard to explain about that. So that is a solution of the exposure t. So t minus one. So that is another difficult object, in fact. So, for example, so that is...
But you forgot the T on the
right. The T on the right. On the right hand side.
This T is different. I'm sorry. T is a coordinate of T.
Okay.
This T is a coordinate. That is a coordinate. I'm sorry. Yeah, but better to use another letter. That is a coordinate of I. So that's the derivation with respect to the coordinate.
But the term on the right.
Do you have a term on the right?
On the target. You
have a T also? Yeah. That's it.
Okay, now it's more confusing.
Okay, so Robert is convinced. Okay, we can. So that's all from there.
Okay, so any questions from Beijing? So, any questions from Beijing? I have one question. So, in your last theorem, you take a module M and take solution and then Horn.
Mm-hmm.
My question is, if you start with an object in EBCX, you take first Horn and the solution, then what is the relation between this one and the original one?
So you have a solution? Yeah. And
the home functor,
home functor, yes.
Yes. So you start with an object in EBCX. You take first the home and then solution. Then what is the relation between
the object.
Ah,
and the,
you mean
the
you take K and.
Yeah.
K, let's see, and it takes position.
Yes.
I don't know. There is a map from. I think it. Let me see. I think there is a functor in this way. But that is not an isomorphism. Yeah. I think.
Okay. So,
think
so you
so,
don't
yeah.
know whether it's. In, yeah.
No. You have to restrict. Yeah. If. I think if it is not holonomic, it is very hard to write it down. So I think it is not well. General case, that's a very good
okay.
point.
Okay.
Well,
I think
that's what I see from the reach down
by.
Does irregularity comes in your story?
But irregularity is more or less you have exponential phi,
yeah,
and that is more or less how wide the phi is.
Yes.
And of course there is, but I don't know. So that is a good idea. Of course. We can say, but it's not clear. I think that, of course, that phi can be recovered from the origin, more or less. So, in that sense, yes, but I think, I don't know,
you have some any way to define the filtrations on the EBCX? Just by looking at irregularities corresponding to the modules.
Describe
it in terms of the local systems.
I don't know. At this moment, I can answer. Yeah, but I don't know. Surprise if even if there's some way.
So on the D-module side, you have you can define character cycles. So can you describe it on in terms of this?
I don't know. Of course, there is a map to DVCX, and that is a solution. And by solution, you can describe the character cycle, but I don't know if that is a good way. I think this one has more. In substance, yes.
I think adding one variable is reminiscent of the twister. So, however, in this case, it's real one dimensional. So, do you have a direct relationship between the twister?
I don't know. Possibly, but I don't know.
Is it
Ah, yeah, yeah. It constructible one. And in fact, the image is contained constructible one, abstractly. But that is still far so, to the essential image.
My question is, in a regular case,
I don't know. I think, as I said, I don't know how to describe the T structure of this one in term in topological term. I don't know.
Yeah, but conversely, I think you proved that.
I think it's not easy.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker. Okay, so now let's thank the speaker again. So goodbye. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.